Well, my name is Gavin Jones. I live in Grangetown in Cardiff, and I've been volunteering for quite a long time in my life in various positions. I originally used to volunteer for BTCV, which is a conservation charity. I did that shortly after completing my degree in 1993, and then I went on to be a full-time volunteer post for about 2 years with the Groundwork Trust, and that was up in Alderman Rochdale as a community officer. For there, a lot of it's about gaining experience, but a lot of it was about working with community groups and getting sort of my hands dirty in community projects and things like that. But I'm mainly going to be talking today about volunteering for the 2012 Olympic Games in London, which is a fantastic experience. I remember when they announced the fact that London had got the Olympics, and I was really chuffed about that. The Olympics are coming to the UK in my lifetime, and I don't think at that point I'd really thought about actually volunteering for it, but then they announced that they were going to need I think it was 75,000 volunteers to help this run, because I think a lot of the criticism they got about the Olympics was the cost and how much it was going to be to run. So the whole volunteer input was going to be really really important to the whole event. So I thought, well, I'll give it a shot, because I think 75,000 does sound a lot, but in context of the amount of people in the UK, it's probably a sort of drop in the ocean, so I thought I'd give it a whirl. So I applied and didn't think anything of it, and the weeks went by, and there was lots of things on the TV about people being recruited, and I hadn't heard anything, so I was beginning to think, oh well, I want to get involved in some way. So I remember putting my name forward for all the tickets, the ticket ballot, just to see if I could get some sort of involvement. And then I had a phone call, a message through saying that someone would like to speak to me about my role. And I thought I originally had put down that I was going to be sort of in the queues and doing a bit of security and things like that, because I'd been a ranger and things like that. So I'd worked security type stuff at events. But no, they're actually interviewing me for the EVS, which is the event services team. So that was all about things like scanning tickets and being the sort of very first person that the visitors to the Olympic Games were going to see. So I didn't have to go anywhere for an interview, but I had a slotted time to be sat next to the phone for someone to ring and talk to me. And I really didn't know what to expect. It was about a half an hour interview. It was full of scenario questions, which are just awful. So they were asking me things like, what was the thing I've been most proud of doing, an example where I've had to sort of confront someone, or not confront them, but deal with confrontation. And it went by in a blur, and I really didn't think I'd done very well in it. So I thought, okay, I got that far. And then I had another phone call saying that we'd like you to come and start the training sessions down in London. So it was like, oh right, okay, that's going to be 2 weeks of out of my work to try to volunteer for. Massive commitment, but first of all I had to take days off and travel down to London, so I was on the earliest mega bus going out to Cardiff, and then on the latest one coming back from London. So a whole day's going into various places in East London to basically the training was really intensive, as you can imagine. A lot of it is about a lot of it was secret as well. We couldn't really talk about the sort of training we had because of security issues, but also I think there'd been a bit of negative press around the Olympics anyway, so it was the usual sort of UK bashing type thing. Oh, are we going to be able to pull this off? Is it going to be sort of... So they didn't want any sort of negative or any news going out about how people were being trained and things like that. So it's fantastic. There were people from all over the UK at these training sessions. Yeah, things to do with security, ranging from lost children to evacuating the Olympic Stadium and what to do then. Looking out for things like pinch points in crowd in case there's any sort of crushing or anything like that, but also how we projected ourselves. So it had to be all about the visitor had to be as welcome at the beginning of the day as they were at the end. So it wasn't just about hello, how are you, welcoming people in. at the end of the day, because things used to finish at 11 o'clock at night and you'd have lots of tired families, we had to be bubbly and really smiley and everything at the end of the night so that those tired families went away with a positive experience. So actually it was quite an eye-opening training regime, really. So there's lots of interactive games and but also a lot of technical stuff as well, learning how to use the radio system and the ticket scanners, which I'll come on to later. That had a whole sort of training to do with there. So I think I did 4 or 5 different training sessions before I got the yes, you've been selected. So that was just one part of the process. So the whole giving up time was started straight away. And I guess a motivation, and it really sort of brought it home to me, was the fact that it wasn't just about being involved in something historical. It was just that whole sort of movement to volunteering that is pretty unique to the UK, I think, to the level that we do it. And I think that really brought it home, because I think it is the most volunteers they've had in the Olympic Games ever, and it was that they really tapped into a movement, and they had over 1 million applicants, so it was pretty. I was pretty pleased to get shortlisted out of those 1 million applicants. But then, as soon as I got the green light, it was a whole lot of other logistics to sort out, because you weren't guaranteed accommodation or anything; you had to find all that yourself. And also work out your travel plans, because they didn't sort of lay the travel plans at first for volunteers. Luckily, my brother lives in Luton, which isn't quite, well, it is if you're an airport, but it isn't really in London, but it is on the commuter belt. So I got in touch with him and said, can I come and stay with you for 2 weeks of the year, when in fact I only see him about twice a year anyway. So I was going to be sharing a house with him for 2 weeks. And I thought, I really couldn't get my head around the London transport system and the times and everything, especially coming from Luton. I said, could you do me a favour, could you work out my my times and everything? Because they sent through the shifts, and the shifts were, I didn't know what to expect with the shift times or anything, but they ranged from 2 o'clock in the afternoon till 11 at night. But the real killers were the 5:20 a.m. times to 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And you also had to be there half an hour before the start of the shift, so I had to work out how I was going to get to, and it's normally well over an hour train journey from Luton to get anywhere near London. So brother came back with the times, and he said, look, you can get the airport train that goes through at 4 o'clock in the morning, and I can get you there, and then it's, you kind of, that's it, you're on the route. But meanwhile, they ended up, because I think they were getting a lot of complaints about, well, this is going to cost a lot of money, you know, for 2 weeks worth of travelling across London, especially coming out. So they did issue all the volunteers with an Oyster card, a prepaid one, which apparently only worked, they're apparently smart enough to register when you're actually working, so you weren't able to use them on your days off, but that was wrong. I managed to use mine on my days off, which is great. So yeah, and in fact, my first shift was on day one of the Olympics, and I was quite nervous. I'd actually worked the Royal Welsh for a week, so I'd been away for a week already, and had to go straight down to London from Bilth, Wales, And I was coming down with something as well, which I'll come to later, which did affect. And I thought, oh no, I'm gonna be day one of the Olympics, I'm gonna be ill. And then, am I gonna get there on time? Because we hadn't tried the transport route out at all. So I got to my brother's quite late, just in time to see the opening ceremony on the TV. And I obviously didn't sleep after that, because I thought, this is massive and it's gone down so well. But now, you know, gonna be part of everything kicking off. So I had about 2 hours sleep, if you can call it sleep. Got up at sort of half past two in the morning, got a breakfast, brother took me to the station at 4 o'clock. Luckily there were some people already there who were obviously games makers as well. But it was funny, because I mean the uniform, it was fine because there were so many of us wearing it, but it was quite different in the way it looked.
Yeah.
So it was quite, I think politely you could call it striking. But I went, when there's thousands of people wearing it, it's fine. So there's some other people turning up, but no one knew how to wear it. So one of the things he said, oh no, you must be really smart and it must be clean, you mustn't smell, which is quite difficult because it's 100% polyester. And it had to be really smart. So I was sat on a train and the guy got on and we didn't know whether to wear the caps or not. We didn't know whether to tuck the shirt in or wear it out. So there's all these kind of nerves, and especially because it was day one. Yeah, it went in a bit of a blur actually. So we had to go for a debrief, but getting across London was quite exciting because the train got to St Pancras Station and they were testing out what they called the Javelin train, which is going to be the train that would take people to the Eurotunnel in Kent. And it was great, it was called the Javelin. So that took us right to the Olympic Park, which again, when I was planning my routes and everything, that wasn't in place then. So I was having to work out going through the underground and things like that. So yeah, we got there first morning. We had a briefing session. There was lots of people from all around the world volunteering. And we were given our assignments and I was on one of the front gates. So at the very first off and people coming in, I was straight at the front. We were put in pairs at the gates and the countdown was there and the atmosphere was just, it was so tangible. I mean, the Olympic Park looked great, the stadium looked great and everything and the way it was set up, but there was just that air of, oh no, this is it now. They'd had the opening ceremony the night before. But this was kind of, you know, when all the sports were kicking off. We all sat at the gates, and I mentioned before that we'd had training with the ticket scanners, and they were about to open the gates, and then someone shouted up, no one's got any scanners. So we've got hundreds of gates at the park with all these people queuing up ready to come in. And there were people, I remember the people at the front of our queue were going, oh, this is a good start. And there were lots of people running about, red-faced and sweaty, bombing around in golf carts and things, trying to issue these scanners as quickly as possible because everyone could just see in their heads the headlines about, oh, you failed at its first go. But yeah, so we were scanning tickets. So I was pretty much scanning about 1,000 people a day, worked out. And funny enough, about a few weeks after I'd finished at the Olympics, I did get tendonitis in the wrist. It suddenly just completely swelled up, and it was due to just this action of scanning tickets. So yeah, and it was just great. Loads of people from around the world had obviously got tickets, so it was really quite good to guess where people were coming from, so we could greet them in my pidgin sort of school French or German, or try and guess. And I always used to get German and Belgian flags mixed up, so I don't think they were getting used to it all the time, and they'd correct you. But yeah, it was fantastic. I think my first shift I actually did with a guy from France, so you had that. It wasn't just people from the UK, it was people from all around. Got to see a fair share of celebrities as well, as you can imagine. People like Condoleezza Rice came through. I had my picture taken with Sally Nugent off BBC Breakfast. Saw Gary Lineker, saw a lot of the athletes. Especially if you're on a really early shift, you could sometimes see them running around the park while it was still shut, just to do their sort of jogging and everything. So yeah, pretty much on the gates all the time. It was really interesting as well because, I don't know if you remember at the time, they brought the armed forces in to boost the security. So we were working with the armed forces on the gates, and I worked with the army, the air force. But we did work with a submarine crew. We were obviously really pleased that they were actually out in the open air and not sort of cooped up. And particularly their submarine commander was particularly interested in dealing with any difficult customers, because you could get people that were quite difficult. And the crazy thing was, people would buy tickets for events just to get into the park, so they thought that they could just walk in any time, and you couldn't, you had to come at your designated event. So you get these people turning up 2 hours after their event expecting to get onto the park, and they wouldn't, so they'd start to be quite aggressive, and then all you had to do was just sort of signal and someone from the armed forces, and it was done. It was there was no arguing after that. And we had one guy. He was really funny actually, but he was a bit worse for wear with drink, and he kept trying to get in. He kept queuing up, getting escorted off. There's no sort of scuffles or anything, and it was just getting beyond a joke. And he was quite big and not necessarily aggressive, but he was kind of throwing his weight around a bit. And this submarine commander came up and said, "Right, that's it. I'm escorting you off." And soon saw the uniform and everything. It really came home to him. But really enjoyed working alongside people like that. Lucky enough to get, they were short staffed at one of the events, so that was the only drawback, I guess, with working on the gates, is that you didn't see much of the event. Didn't matter because the atmosphere was brilliant, but you got to see handball, which was something I've never watched before. But it was funny seeing the banter between the countries, because they take it really seriously on the continent. So I think it was Croatia against Austria or something in the handball, and the banter between the crowd was amazing, and it was quite an exciting game to be involved in. It was, going back to what the atmosphere was like in the park, it was so positive, and I think that's what made it worth it. It didn't feel like a chore. It didn't feel like, I mean, you were exhausted, but everyone was there for a positive reason, and it really sort of, it was really infectious, and it kept us going, because it's a long day on your feet, and the breaks were great. The canteen was fantastic. There was good meals every day. The only thing was, we were issued with snacks to sort of take away with us, and there were these, I still kept one, don't know what state it's in, these Nature Valley crunchy bars, and everyone was so sick of them by the end of 2 weeks that they started to mass in people's bags. So I did keep one as a bit of a momentum, but, and I know that summer had been really wet, and they were worried that the whole 2 weeks were going to be wet, but it actually turned out to be really hot weather during that week. But sort of the last thing you want for a dry mouth is a dry harvest sort of crunchy bar. Right, what else? Measure temperatures. Yes, I was coming down with something before I started, and so I bought one of those horrible spray things that's supposed to be sort of ward off a cold, and I thought if I keep using that for 2 weeks, it'll ward it off and I can come down with something. But halfway through, because you're constantly talking to people, and if you're on a late shift, you were pretty much you're basically saying goodbye to people. So you were high-fiving lots of children, however hard they smashed into your hand, you still had to sort of smile and say have a good trip and everything. So you're talking all the time, and at the end of luckily at the end of a late shift before a break, a couple of days break, my voice completely went, and I've never had that before. It absolutely went to, there was nothing there, it was like a proper croak. And by that time the whole country was really excited about the Olympics, and it was all buzzing, and I caught the late train home, and I sat in a carriage, and a lovely couple were talking to me and asking me loads of questions, and I couldn't respond, but I was going like, "No, it's really good, really good," and they just kept asking me, and they didn't really they couldn't really gauge the fact that I hadn't got a voice, and I was trying to explain, yeah, it's really great, really love working it. So I had about 2 or 3 days for it to come back, and I had to go to a chemist and get some spray, but luckily it came back for my sort of second phase of shifts on the games. Met some fantastic people. There's a guy from Montserrat, which is Crown Connolly, called Elridge Bodkin, which is a fantastic name, but he was a great bloke, and he'd worked at Atlanta, he volunteered at Atlanta as well, so there's a bit of comparison there. Worked a shift with a guy from South Africa, and it was just a really good atmosphere, and it was really hard work, but it didn't feel like a chore, and it was a joy to volunteer for, and you felt part of something. You didn't feel, I don't think you get it very often, but they're obviously paid staff there, but there was good, you didn't feel like you weren't excluded or second class citizen. But it was just the fact that you all felt part of a big family, and I mentioned the fact that the uniforms were quite distinctive. I always remember coming in on one early shift, and you'd get off the javelin train, you'd have to go through a big shopping centre to get to the Olympic Park, and there's a huge escalator, an outside escalator leading into the shopping centre. I remember coming out one morning and it was just this snake of this uniform going up the escalator and out. It just brought home how we did feel really part of everything. I think were there any grumbles? I think there's a few grumbles. I think there's that thing about some of the empty seats as well. So I know they were giving them up to people, but they were saying, well, you should give some to the volunteers as well. So so that was a minor grumble, really. But no, it was just a fantastic experience, and I did volunteer for the 2014 Commonwealth Games as well. Complete sort of different experience, but yeah, volunteering for the Olympics was fab, and you really did feel appreciated. I mean, I had obviously this mass produced letter from the Prime Minister, but it was little touches like that. We got a nice silver baton that was presented afterwards, but they even gave you a journal, and I'm not a brilliant person for keeping a journal on anything, but there was the commemorative baton. The journal was great because it really forced me to sort of write everything down and just remember the stories and the people I met. But even that, you know, I've kept everything. The shift timetable, 5:45 in the morning was pretty early start. I get about 2 hours, 3 hours sleep beforehand. But it's great, and I got time to spend with my brother. In fact, if you're curious where I keep all this stuff, my dad actually had a box made for me to put it all away, so it wasn't just stashed in a bag or anything. Going back to talking about the security, we had to have so much sort of security tags on us. So this was around our neck all the time, and you would get if it flipped round, you did get sort of not shouted at, but people would tell you to flip it round so they can see, and it gave you limited access. So part of the training was actually recognising what codes, because sometimes you'd be on a security gate and you'd have to recognise all these different codes and combinations to allow people in or not allow people in. We had that as well. And then on the back, they had a bit of a reward system, which was a good idea. So once you completed a shift, you got a cross or a tick, and then that meant you got something as a prize. A lot of it was sort of pin badges. Now, pin badges were the rage. It was a selection there. So you got all these. So you got silver, bronze, gold pin badges. You got the gold when you completed all your shifts, but there are lots of others being given out. We were told not to be swapping pin badges, but people did. People went mad. They put those pin badges on their lanyards. I got one because I took. That was the other thing we did. We ended up doing a lot of taking pictures of people, especially if someone was in a couple, maybe two of them. We wanted to make sure that they got a picture with both of them in the shot, so we'd start taking their cameras off people, say, not literally taking them off them, but asking, do you want a picture taken to them? And I only dropped someone's phone, and I was like, oh no, that's it, I'm going to get into trouble. But yeah, it was great. So taking loads of pictures, and there was a British Airways flight attendant, she was on her own, and she was just taking a picture. I said, oh, do you want a picture of you with it all, with the stadium in the background? She said, oh yeah, brilliant. She gave me that one, actually, which is the quite a rare one, a British Airways Olympic pin badge. So, but I didn't go into the whole swapping thing. I was quite happy with the ones we were given. This was the pocket guide you were issued with, and this had all the map where everything was, because obviously you had to point people in the right direction. All these names and numbers of people, if you were running late or whatever, you had to sort of ring in, say where you were. Anyone else? And all the emergency procedures if there was anything. I think we only had one minor emergency on our gate. Yeah, that was quite exciting, actually. There was a lady in a wheelchair caught her leg on something, and she was quite elderly, so it bled a lot. And we couldn't find a doctor because they had these medical teams running around. So it was three of us running around the whole stadium trying to find this doctor's. It was quite a long sort of golf buggy type thing to get them to come over. But luckily, there was an army medic there, and I just sort of patched her up. But that was that added a bit of excitement. That meant we could do a bit of running around rather than standing around.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
How do you think this volunteering affected you? What difference did it make to you personally?
It's a cliche. I find it really enriching as an experience, and I think there's a certain amount of trepidation before it because I thought, you know, I wonder what I signed up for. I wonder how much I'm going to be, you know, is going to be asked of me to volunteer. But I really felt I was contributing to something, and that was the reward. It didn't. The whole ticket scanning, for example, was a real slog, but it didn't feel like it. It was saying that whole positive, and it wasn't. If you felt like you were achieving something, I think that's really important. If you volunteer, that you enjoy it and you feel like it's not just a case of collecting, being rewarded through pin badges or batons or anything like that. It's about that reward, that reward to your spirit, and the fact that yes, you contributed to something, but what I got out of it was really enriching. You know, I've never met anyone from Montserrat. I would never necessarily work with people in a working environment from a global community rather than anything else. So that was a real inspiration behind it, and it's rewarding. I think it's very much in the psyche of people in the UK to have that in them. And I would recommend it to anyone because the reward is that the reward is in there, I think. So it's not just about receiving trinkets or anything.
Did you get a feel for how as volunteers you affected other people or wider community?
I remember people thinking, funny enough, talking to people on the trains and even talking to my brother. Really wished he'd sort of volunteered for it. Because I think, again, there was an element of that. It was a time thing as well. I think talking to people, they think, I didn't think I was going to get the time to do it. There's not enough time in my life to volunteer. Well, actually, there is. I managed to sort of give 2 weeks of my life to it, and it didn't feel like that. I think it's just taking that plunge, I think, and it's quite a wrench, and it's whatever your perception of volunteering is. And I think people could see that it was how fulfilling it was for those people volunteering, and the fact that we were enjoying what we did, and that positivity, we were feeding off other people's positivity, and we had it in ourselves. So for the wider community, I think they really appreciate it. Hopefully that did kind of stimulate people to volunteer, and I know that was one of the the legacy word. And I said that was one of the hopes they were saying that this would kick on to volunteer for other stuff. And as I say, I volunteered for the Commonwealth Games, but as an ethos of volunteering, it definitely had an impact. And I think because of the coverage they had, and the fact that I think it gave a good profile to people who volunteer for all sorts of things. But yeah, just from one-to-one, talking to people on the train, going, oh, that sounds amazing. And you do have time to volunteer. It's just that we're so much in a bubble, I think, in everyday life, that you don't think you've got time. But yeah, very rewarding.
And what do you understand by the term volunteering? What does that mean to you?
That's a good point. It's on a very basic level, it's giving your time for a cause, but it's giving a part of your life to something. What would be the spirit of volunteering? I think if you volunteer to put an event on in your community, or you volunteer for a sports club, it is totally fulfilling. It feels like I tell you what, it feels like your best, most productive day at work, but all the time. And I think that's I think if you try to get people into volunteering, that would be the way to describe it. Think about the best day you've had at work, the day you've driven from work and thought, oh, I've achieved something today. You know, I wouldn't say I've earned my dollar, but volunteering is like that all the time, and that's what I understand it to be.